our seats, let's get this show on the road.
All right.
Surprise!
I heard you were doing it.
Places, everyone.
Places, everyone.
Sit down. Go to your room. Okay, good evening and welcome to Rincon Valley Cowboy Church. Any first time guests this evening? No? Okay. Continue to pray for the construction of our new church and adjacent 9 acres, and specifically for a contractor and the building team and all of that, okay? Continue to use your common sense regarding your health. Weird times out there, people. Let's put our thinking caps on, okay? Wash your hands if you're sick or have a low immune system. Stay at home and see your doctor immediately. There are masks on the back table if anyone needs one. And tonight we have a special treat. We have a business meeting. If you're a member, I don't want to see you be ducking out of here either. Chase you down and lasso you. I'll have Ken lasso you. There you go. Tide boot is over on the table. Online giving's on the website. Buck for a barn is over on the table. And also, January 2nd. We are having a Kevin potluck send-off. We're not gonna barbecue him. Although we probably should.
A little bit of barbecue sauce, a little bit of butter.
It's our way of telling our missionary from our very own little church here that we love him, we're gonna continue to support him, and so we're going to have a fiesta that evening, January 2nd. Along those same lines. Anybody in the market for a cat?
Is it cow rats?
It's a mouser, I understand. Hey, Kevin, is your cat worthless or will it catch mice? It's worthless. Okay. Kevin can't. We're going to barbecue the cat, too?
That's yeah, my girl.
This is America, not Vietnam.
Oh, my.
Oh, dear.
I said it out loud. Sorry. Kevin can't take the cat with him, so need somebody to step up, okay?
Is it an outdoor cat or an indoor cat?
It's a fluffy, indoor. Worthless cat.
He's strictly indoor.
It's
fluffy.
It's outdoor. My parents
No, I know.
He's strictly indoor.
Lou, Betsy, you need a new cat.
No, I can't have another one.
We got 2 cats.
Well, you need 3? I got 3 dogs.
Lou's got some sense. She needs to talk to Betsy.
Betsy, would you like a new cat?
Oh, I'd love it. But Lou, okay. Lou would kill me.
She wants it.
Oh, thank
right.
you for being here.
I don't want to go there.
We've got quite a night in store, so let's pray. Father God, thank you for these folks. Please just pour out your blessings on each and every one of them. And Lord, please find us faithful in attending to the fact that you are the reason for the season. And it's in Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen.
Thanks, Eddie.
Just went on and on. I ain't from Vietnam. Turn to page 18.
18, friends. Stand. Stand. Let's sing and stand. Turn to 18 all at the same time. Have you tried the cookies?
Yes.
I tried one of each. I am too.
And he had coffee.
And I had a little coffee. I had to wash it down.
Ready for the
I attest, every one of those cookies are good. The chocolate is my favorite. How about it? Let's do it. Good tamales today. Anybody get good tamales yet?
Yes.
I got some good tamales today.
Where?
I can't tell you. You know how. It was funny. I was calling people or texting them, hey, do you know where to get tamales? And I thought, man, that sounds like I'm asking for drugs, you know? Hey, do you know where to score some tamales? Yeah. But it was a carniceria over on Crake Rock. Yep. Los Vaqueros. That's
the
right. That's the one. Yep. Oh,
place.
Lord, they were good. Thank you, Jesus. 60. 60.
Hearing not my voice to soothe thy
John. Hey, before we go any further, I want to ask my lovely and talented assistant here to tell us about
the
magic show.
Sorry.
Can you do some magic?
Nope.
Tell a funny, clean joke. Bet you don't. All right.
So, yeah, I haven't been here in a couple weeks. A little COVID scare, but that was negative. So, we have one more week on our special Christmas offering, and it grew a lot since I saw that. We only have, what, 600-ish to go? So let's get this going. So I was doing devotions this week, and God, I was in Romans, and where is it? I was in Romans 10, and he gave me this verse, and it was really appropriate for missions. Romans 10, 13 and 14 says, "For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. How then can they call on the one that they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one whom they have not heard of? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them?"
Amen.
That, I mean, like, wow, bam. This is so, so important. Everybody needs to hear the word of the Lord. Everybody deserves to hear the word of the Lord. And it's about missions. So be generous. Somebody's calling me.
How about that?
Hey. I'm glad I had it on my brain. And anyways, we've got a full week, so let's get it done. $1,500, let's go.
Woo! Yeah, 630 left. Dig deep, friends, dig deep.
Dig deep.
Turn to page 42. This one's in D, Ray's favorite key, if you're tapping your foot. Thank you. special song coming. You know, in the middle of COVID, this church has seemed to thrive. It's just amazing how God has blessed this church.
Amen.
Yeah, we're little, but God has done some wonderful things. And, yeah, little things can do great things if God's involved. And we gained 6 members just recently. Praise God. And 2 of them are musicians. And so we don't do a whole lot of special music here, but, well, we're going to have some next year. And so I asked Julia if she would play us a song for Christmas.
She thought you were a little taller than Christmas.
Can you
fix it?
Paul's going to help with the song.
I'm ready and everything.
You ready? Okay. Ready? Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain. Jesus Christ is born. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain, Jesus Christ is born. While shepherds kept their watches over silent flocks by night, behold, throughout the heavens, they shone a holy light. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. The shepherds feared and trembled. Thank you. the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Jesus Christ is born. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Jesus Christ is born. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Wow, beautiful. Amen?
Amen?
I'll tell you what, we all need Taylor guitars, Ray. Go trade that old Martin garbage in. Absolutely. Beautiful, beautiful singing. Paul, you did okay.
I wasn't really looking for your opinion.
Oh, praise the Lord. Started this week out to get my sermon ready and started doing the axe thing, and then I got to looking at it and I'm like, man, I don't know, it didn't feel right. And so I started thinking, oh my goodness, it's gonna be Christmas the following Thursday. And so I looked at Christmas sermons that I've done in the past, and I'm like, well, boy, I've done a lot of Christmas sermons on the same exact verses, you know? What do you say about Christmas, you know? I'll do it again. And then I saw the shepherds and the angels, you know, right after this, you know, verses 8 and following, in Luke, or in Luke 2. And so I began to write three different outlines. And ladies, you know this about men. Multitasking is not a good thing. Because I started getting these three outlines together and I got overwhelmed. I started freaking out. I was like, oh my gosh, what am I going to do? And then the next day I went back to the one sermon and I thought, oh, yeah, I'm a little better off now if I concentrate on one thing. Very interesting that I've heard that men, their brains and the things that they do, they're compartmentalized, right? It's like cubby holes. And this goes here and that goes there, and that's the way we do. But women, they're like spaghetti. They're like a bowl of spaghetti, right? You know, and the thoughts are going back and forth. And a buddy of mine, went out to lunch. Okay, we call it dinner when I was growing up, but lunch with a buddy of mine, and he said his wife and him were getting into arguments and whatnot, and they were arguing over she does 10,000 things and does them well at once, and he does four, and I work on these four, and that's all I can do, and I'm like, I hear you, bro. You know, I totally get that. So, here's where we wound up with the birth of Jesus. So, turn to Luke 2. Luke chapter 2. Linus talked about this, didn't he? On Charlie Brown Christmas special. They don't have those kind of things anymore, do they? Well, I mean, a new cartoon having Luke 2 recited.
No.
Yeah. VeggieTales, well, we can always rely on them.
Yeah.
But no VeggieTale is as good as Jonah. Wasn't that the greatest one? We did Jonah. We went through verse by verse in church, Jonah. And then we sat in the room across from us here, and we watched VeggieTales Jonah after the sermon. And it was wonderful. I especially love the guy dressed like Elvis at the end, right? The cucumber dressed like Elvis.
What?
He was wonderful. Gotta watch it. You gotta watch it. All right, Luke 2, 1 through 7. Here we go. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration when Quirinius was governor of Syria. And all went to be registered, each to his own town. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth, to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth, and she gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, God, we just thank you for this verse, because with this passage, Lord, all other passages come together. We thank you for the birth of your son. And this is where it all begins. So, Lord, I pray for that soul that's not saved to understand the birth of Jesus and the importance of it and your sovereignty that brought it all together. We love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Anybody watching Mandalorian? Man, that was a great episode last night, right? But the thing about Mandalorian is this baby. Baby Yoda. I mean, he makes the whole show, right? I mean, the rest of them are going, what the heck are you talking about? Babies are great. Babies are awesome. Nathaniel John was born. Yeah, and so we're so excited. We love him, and we haven't even seen him. And I don't know when we will because of COVID-19, you know? It's just crazy. The baby's still in the hospital. Make sure you keep the baby in prayer because he's got a cleft palate, and feeding has been kind of nuts. So keep him in prayer. But I understand he's doing better, correct? He is doing better. But we're excited about that, right? We're going to have a granddaughter in April. I mean, babies being born is so exciting. It's a wonderful thing. I'll never forget JT being born. And just what an incredible, incredible blessing that was to witness it, number one. But also just all of a sudden it being real, you know, that you're a father and just a parent. It's just amazing. But, you know, no birth can be as important as the birth of Jesus Christ. Not even yours, Daniel. Not even your birth. Jesus Christ was the most amazing birth, the greatest birth ever. And as we think of Jesus there in the manger, we Debbie, did you see we brought the manger from the ranch? As weak as a baby, we see all the folks around and the baby laying in the manger, and you can say, oh, so little, so weak. But it's a common expression that could not be applied to that baby, Jesus, in the manger. While he was as weak as any other baby, humanly speaking, he was also the center of power as far as heaven was concerned. Tonight we're going to talk about the greatest birth ever. The birth of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Number one, Caesar's census. Number one and two. Verses one and two. So, got some... We'll talk about these verses first before we really dig in to the rest of it. Jesus was born in Bethlehem because of a decree, and that is a command from Caesar Augustus, okay? Now, Caesar obviously has got some power, right? He's ruling, but God is the one who's in charge. God used Caesar's edict to put Mary and Joseph 80 miles from Nazareth to Bethlehem to fulfill his word. That's my God. Right place at the right time, right? That's my God. In our passage, I'm sorry she embarrassed you there, Newton.
In those days, the passage says, in those days, and that suggests that Jesus, that Luke did not know the exact time, okay? In those days, all the world, the passage says, that means the entire world, inhabited world, that was subject to Rome, okay? The Roman Empire. People were registered for the purpose of taxation. Something interesting. Palestine was pretty, depends if you live in Texas or in Israel, right? Palestine previously would not have been included in the census. You know why? Because the census was to find young men to be in the Roman army. But if you were a Jew, you couldn't be in the Roman army. And it later changed that the census was for levy poll taxes, okay? To levy poll taxes. According to Josephus, Quirinius was governor of Syria in AD 6 to 7 and conducted a census in AD 6, which Luke mentions, we talked about this, in Acts 5:37. Okay, remember that? But this cannot be the census Luke is referring to here, since it occurred after the death of Herod the Great in 4 BC. And Jesus was born during Herod's time, right? How do we know that? Because Matthew 2:1 says, now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, right? Behold, wise men came from the east, blah, blah, blah. Luke 1:5 also says, in the days of Herod, king of Judah, there was a priest named Zechariah of the division of Abijah, and he had a wife from the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. So, because Herod the Great's reign ended in 4 BC, Jesus was born before that time. Okay? Also, picture this, because my brain was just kind of whack all week. But when we're talking BC, we're going 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 2, 3, right? Okay? We're going down. And when we're going AD, we're going up like normal years, okay? So you got to keep that in mind as we're talking. 4 BC is 1, 2, 3, 4 up from the starting point. Jesus was born before 4 BC. Luke would then be clarifying that this was before that well-known troublesome census of AD 6 in Acts 5:37. Okay? The most reasonable date for the registration is late in the year of 6 BC or early 5. Okay? So if it's late, maybe it was late December, right? Maybe it was December 24th. So the mention of Quirinius as governor of Syria poses a problem. And as stated before, he was governor in AD 6 through 7, and it was much too late for Jesus' birth. We're talking about Luke, okay? So Luke wrote the book of Luke, right? Luke wrote Acts, what we're going through right now. And he took meticulous care as a historian. Luke was no slouch in writing. And archaeology, don't you love archaeology? Because it keeps proving the Bible over and over again. It just keeps showing the truth of the Bible. And you know what it does a lot of times? It proves Luke right. It shows that Luke was correct in his writing over and over. Check this out. in 1764, there was a fragment of stone found, okay? And it was found near Rome at Tivoli. And the inscription was in honor of a Roman official that was twice governor, okay, of Syria and Phoenicia during the reign of Augustus. And there was no name on it, but there it told of his accomplishments on this stone. And the accomplishments given fit no one else but Quirinius. Okay? So, he must have served twice. He must have served twice. And Luke's readers, they would have known that. It would have been nothing for them. But those who want to discredit the Bible, they jump on this kind of stuff. But when we dig in and we look at archaeology and what it's shown us, their argument has no validity. Amen? God's word is truth. All right, number two. From Nazareth to Bethlehem, verses 3-5. For the census, Joseph and Mary went to Bethlehem, and that was Joseph's ancestral home. And what does it say in verse 4? It says they went up to Judea. Now, we've talked about this over and over again. When we see something that says they went up to, but it's south of Jerusalem, we tend to go, wait, how'd they go up? Because we talk about going up to Phoenix, right? Mm-hmm. We talk about going down to John's house, you know, from my house. Going down to John's house. Well, the reason they say up to Judea, even though it's south of Jerusalem, is because Bethlehem in Judea lies on a mountain that's 2,654 feet high. So you got to go up to go to it. Even though geographically you're going south, you're going up. And I want you to know that this would have been a tough trip for Mary. A pregnant woman riding on a donkey, right? But you know what? She was glad to do God's will. She was probably glad to get away from Nazareth too. Joseph was a descendant of David, who was born in Bethlehem. Mary accompanied Joseph for several reasons. Who else was a descendant of David? Oh, well, okay. Joseph and Mary. Yeah, both of them were descendants, right? So both of them needed to go to Bethlehem for that reason. The couple knew that she was would have the baby during the time of Joseph, that Joseph was going to be gone, and they most likely did not want to be separated during that event. Okay, so there's another reason. Also, both knew that the child was the Messiah. How did they know that? The angels came to both of them, right? Or the angel. They also would have known the Messiah was to be born in Bethlehem. How would they have known that? Because of God's word, right? They all knew it. Micah 5:2 says, but you are Micha, right, Daniel? Micha. Yeah. Yeah, that's what I put in the bulletin last year. Remember that? Micha. Yeah, I know you remember. Because you pointed it out to me, man. Micha 5:2. But you, O Bethlehem Ephrathah, who are too little to be among the clans of Judah, listen to this. From you shall come forth for me one who is to be ruler in Israel, whose coming forth is from old, from ancient days. Friends, even if they had not known, God would have put them there to fulfill the prophecy. God will get his way. You guys realize that? God will get his way. Kevin, if you're not supposed to be in Louisville, Kentucky, make sure you say Louisville, not Louisville. God will take you back out of Louisville. If you're supposed to be there, everything's going to go fine. And that's the way God works. Man, he will set it straight. Listen to him. Nobody knows better than me that when you know God's saying, it's time to go, and you don't go, friends, he'll move you. And usually that's not pleasant, at least in my experience. So make sure that you're listening to God. Number three, the birth of Jesus, verses 6-7. The time came. What time? The time for the Savior of the world to be born. Amen? Micah 5:2 says that. Well, you know what else? Matthew 2:1-6. Now, we already read one. It says, now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him. When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And assembling all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. Listen to this, verse 5. They told him, in Bethlehem of Judea, for so it is written by the prophet, verse 6, and you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for you, from you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel. So he's quoting who there? Micha, right? Right, Daniel? Micah. Right. Being wrapped in strips of cloth was important, for this was the way the shepherds, we're going to talk about next week, but that's the way the shepherds would recognize the infant. We'll see that in verse 12 next week. Swaddling clothes, or cloths rather, were strips of cloth that were that wrapped the baby to keep them warm and secure. Did you ever get that down? Did you have time to get the whole wrapping the baby up like a burrito thing? Good. I'm not sure that I did, and I had a whole lot more time than you. I can wrap a burrito though, brother. Amen. But there's something about you've had my burrito. But there's something about doing that baby that just don't work as well as a tortilla. I don't know. You know what it also does? Them babies, they got these claws. And they'll scratch themselves, right? Little baby fingernails are sharp. They're like razors. They're like kittens, you know? You gave birth to a kitten. And also, you want their arms to be straight, their limbs to be straight and unharmed. I'll never forget, you know, your firstborn, you don't know anything, right? You're just totally green. And so here we are. We're in San Angelo at Shannon Medical Center. And they come in, and gosh, it's like the first day. You know, he still looks like a lizard, right? You know? I mean, and they're like, we need to take a picture. We want to take a picture. And me and Linda's like, duh, I guess this is what you do, you know, take a picture. And so they take a picture of this little scary looking mortal, you know, and he's got like mittens on. I still run across this picture and I laugh. So it's kind of funny that I took it or paid for it, you know. But he's got like one hand across here and one going up like he's saying, you know, the pledging or swearing on a Bible or something. And it was so he wouldn't scratch himself. They put these little mittens on his hands. And he's crying, of course, you know, so he looks like he's just upset as can be. But that was JT's first picture. You know, this whole wrapping and stuff, they obviously still do that here. But as far as swaddling cloths, that's still practiced in some Eastern cultures. And the absence of it would show a sign of, or would be a sign of poverty. if you didn't do that. Ezekiel 16:4, or Ezekiel, as we learned last week, Ezekiel 16:4 says, "And as for your birth, on the day you were born, your cord was not cut, nor were you washed with water to cleanse you, nor rubbed with salt, nor wrapped in swaddling cloths." So, you got to read Ezekiel chapter 16 to get the full gist of that. The child was based, was basted. Yeah, no more coughing. That's it. I knew better. The child was placed in a manger from which livestock fed. Okay? And think about that for a minute. The Savior of the world was born in the most humble of settings. Man, when you wrap your mind around that, you begin to understand Jesus. That's crazy. And you know, our little manger scene over here, I'm not sure that the actual manger looked like that with saguaro ribs across the roof. Maybe it did. But, in fact, I'm sure it didn't. But you get the idea that it was pretty humble setting. And that baby is God. Yet some today base their, and others, worth on the possessions they own. You see it every day. I see it every day. It just breaks my heart. What matters is Christ and how you see him, how you understand him, the forgiveness that he gives us. That's what matters. The love that he has for us as Christians, that's what matters. Have you received him as your personal Savior? Man, that's really what matters. The couple was housed in quarters that were not private. The inn, with the definite article "the," indicates that this was a specific, officially known lodging place for travelers. And what was about the inn? It was full. Why? Many had come to Bethlehem to register for the census. And according to tradition, they weren't in a little stall like that, a pole barn thing. They were in a cave. Way more likely that they were in a cave than a structure like that. Manger actually could mean feeding trough, like the baby's laid in, right? Or it could mean a place where you store your animals, a structure to house the animals. And then finally, at the end of that verse 7, the fact that Jesus was called Mary's firstborn, it implies that she later had other children. I used to work at Fry's in the photo lab. It was a one-hour photo. And it was just crazy the way that I got that job. But while working there, I was at Lambert and La Quinata, as far as I could be from here, you know. But Lambert and La Quinata, and there was a priest, a Catholic priest that would come in there. I would have never known this dude was a priest. Because he came in with like one of them floppy hats, you know, and shorts, and he's a little skinny old man. But the dude I was working with was Catholic, and so, man, he, you know, this priest would come in and say, "Ooh, man, here's the priest," you know. And so I knew he was a priest from him. Well, he started bringing me pictures, and this was no, you know, slump priest. I don't know if all priests do this, but this dude would go over to, like, the Vatican, and he'd go to these big Catholic churches in Europe, and he would take these pictures, and these pictures were amazing. John Paul was the Pope at that time. He had pictures of John Paul in his little Pope-mobile thing going by, you know, the bulletproof glass and stuff. I was like, that's awesome. He had pictures one day that had chains in them, and they were in this really cool box. And I'm like, what the heck is this, you know? And he said that those are the chains of Peter. And so they believe that, and they're like deep down in the cellar. Isn't that, you know, you're not seeing this when you come into Mass. You know, they have all these, what do you call them, relics? They have all these relics. They're, you know, somewhere that is the spear and, you know, all this stuff. The Holy Grail is somewhere, and Indiana Jones got that, I think. But I remember in the news, they had said that they had found the bones of James. They had found a box, and in the box was apparently the bones of James. And so, man, just happened that day that priest come in. And so, man, I hadn't received the call to ministry yet. And you know how easily, you know, and how tame I am, you know. I don't try to say anything that I shouldn't, you know. So I'm sitting there, and the priest comes in. I said, what do you think of this, priest? You know, and so he's like, well, they say, you know, that it's James, and I said, yeah, the brother of Jesus, right? And he says, well, we don't believe that Jesus had any brothers or sisters. And I thought, man, that ain't what the Bible says. Remember how deep we went into, those of you who have been here for a while, how deep we went into it in Mark, and we talked about all the brothers and where it points out that he's got the brothers and sisters and names them by name, right? So I found that interesting, that the Catholics do not believe that Mary had any other children, even though the Bible's pretty clear that she did. And nevertheless, this baby that was born was the greatest birth ever. Friends, those who won't believe in God will try to find something wrong with the Bible, but their argument holds no weight. God came to us as a man to live a perfect life and to be that perfect sacrifice that we may have a chance to be with him eternally. He was born and lived in the humblest situation. He was born where? In Bethlehem. You know what Bethlehem means? House of bread. Isn't that neat? Jesus Christ was the bread of life. We must humble ourselves to become his children. The question is, can you do that? Can you humble yourself? Man, humbling yourself starts with understanding that you are a sinner and admitting that. If we can't admit that we're sinners, it ain't going to happen. There is none that is good. No, not one. That takes humility. There's only one who can forgive those sins. And that one was born that night, Jesus Christ. Let's go, Lord, in prayer. Most gracious and heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for this night and the passage. And God, it all boils down to your Son. We thank you for Jesus Christ being born. We thank you for coming to the earth as a man. We thank you for dying on the cross. Jesus, you're the one. You're the only way to heaven. You are the way and the truth and the life. And no one can come to the Father except through you. God, I pray that if there's any who need to know Jesus personally, that they would not hesitate to call. They would not hesitate to talk to me after the service, after the business meeting.
You're so good to us, God. We deserve nothing, and you give us everything. You even give us the faith. So thank you, Lord. I pray for my brothers and sisters. This Christmas season would be an awesome one, regardless of COVID-19 and everything else going on in the world. I just pray, God, that you would bless us all. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. All right, guys, I will give us 120 seconds. You have 2 minutes. Stand up, stretch your feet, use that bathroom, and get back in here, and we're going to start and get this thing over with, okay? Okay.